Our last, but definitely not the last speaker for today is Sai Jyotirmay Racheela, Deputy Executive Director at Arrow. A feminist and an advocate of women's rights, Sai has more than, in fact, almost 25 years of experience working on issues of right to health, maternal health, gender, and sexual and reproductive health and rights. Today, she will take stock of the progress made on the ground on the various global promises made by our leaders in advancing gender equality and human rights in the region. Over to you, Sai.
Thank you, Shobha, and good day to everyone. Thus far, what we have seen since the beginning of this whole training is what have been the different global commitments pertaining to gender equality and sexual and reproductive health and rights. And I have also understood that some of the speakers have also looked at what is the situation in reality, what are the numbers telling us, and what is actually the situation in regards to gender equality and sexual and reproductive health and rights. I've also seen some of the speakers actually talking about making changes in the structural and the systemic domains of work in order to make this whole impact and to ensure that gender equality actually happens. I think my presentation will basically summarize everything and then basically take stock of what has been the progress on walking the talk, what has been the progress around gender equality and human rights in the Asia Pacific region. We can go to the next slide. So what I've done is I've chosen the framework of the SDGs. Because whether we are talking about the ICPD program of action, the Nairobi commitments, whether we are talking about the Beijing platform for action and the Generation Equality Forum commitments, at the end of the day, looking at the SDG framework, which is the Agenda 2030 for Sustainable Development, this is something that many of our governments are more or less, they are aligned to, they are aware of it. And in many of our countries, we know that some of the planning commissions and different government departments are working towards ensuring that the SDGs are implemented. So very specifically, we all know that in 2015, our governments have adopted the Agenda 2030 for Sustainable Development. It has 17 goals. And within the 17 goals, there is one goal that is focused on gender equality, and that is goal 5. Within this goal, you have about 6 targets. The first one is focused on ending all forms of discrimination. The second target is focused on ending all forms of violence in public sphere and in private sphere. The third target is focused on eliminating harmful practices such as child marriage, early and forced marriages, and female genital mutilation. The fourth target is looking at recognizing and valuing unpaid work. The fifth target is looking at participation, decision-making, and political representation of women. And towards the end, the last target is looking at ensuring universal access to sexual and reproductive health and rights. And if you follow this target, it actually says in accordance with the program of action of the ICPD, which is the International Conference on Population and Development, and the Beijing Platform for Action, and the outcome documents. And that's the reason why I have chosen this framework in order to take stock. We can go to the next slide. So now let us see what is exactly happening in the region in regards to gender equality and sexual and reproductive health and rights. Many of our speakers have also talked about this, and we have to sadly say that the Asia and the Pacific region is not on track to achieve any of the 17 SDGs by 2030. The COVID-19 pandemic has actually put the gear towards the reverse gear, and it has further exacerbated the inequalities. And in the current trajectory, the region may achieve about less than 10% of the SDG targets. When it comes to evidence, the evidence is also very limited on gender equality. And this evidence or the data that is present, it does not take into account the full spectrum of gender identities, such as including LGBTIQ+. And there is very little data for that is available. I mean, in terms of the most recent 2021 SDG progress report, it actually says that 2 out of the 9 SDG targets could be measured, and the data that are available show that the progress is low, which means that on many other targets where there are indicators, we need to still have our national statistical offices generate data and be able to generate that data. Available data against the SDG indicators, it highlights significant inequalities for women, for girls, and for marginalized communities. And as I have just said, that the data gaps are very much, there is a huge, there's a big gap in actually even collecting data around the respective indicators. Can we go to the next slide? So I have shown you the targets, the different targets, and target number one is ending all forms of discrimination against women and girls everywhere. Here you will also see that, again, it's a very binary way of looking at the targets. And if you look at this target, it actually calls for the removal of discriminatory laws, but also establishing legal frameworks that promote, enforce, and monitor gender equality. This can be laws and policies around gender equality and sexual and reproductive health and rights. It can include policies, plans, and also the allocation of financial resources. And this target basically monitors that aspect. And what is the result? The result is that there has been uneven progress in ensuring legal reform to remove discrimination and promote gender equality. And I've heard Bipu say, I've also heard Reena talk about it, and especially in our South Asian countries, patriarchal values and social norms, these keep the gender inequalities alive. And there are discriminatory practices which even begin before birth. So even to just give an example, when it comes to the marital rape, for instance, this is not recognized, it is not criminalized in India. And India, amongst the Southeast, South and Southeast Asian countries, constitutes a large proportion of women. And again, these are those discriminations that we are talking within the legal framework. A lot of work has to be done within this target. We go to the next slide. Again, the second target on violence, and this measures intimate partner violence, and it also measures non-partner violence, such as people who you do not know. And for the Asia and the Pacific region, the most recent data actually says that the prevalence of such violence is about 15 to 64%. And this actually, women have disclosed that they have experienced physical and or sexual violence by an intimate partner at some point in their lifetime. We can go to the next slide. And this is just a graph. This is from UNFPA, which actually shows that among the, and we do not have very much of data around violence against women. And of the data that is available, this graph basically points out to the percentage of women who have disclosed that they have experienced violence by an intimate partner in the last 12 months, which is the orange. And then the gray circle points out to who have experienced violence in their lifetime. So the orange is in the last 12 months and the gray is around the lifetime. And here you see some of our, the data for some of our countries. There, Papua New Guinea, it's 58, Bangladesh, 54, and countries like Timor-Leste, 59, Vanuatu, 60, Fiji, 64, and this is what is the current data that is pointing out to violence against women. We can go to the next slide. So the other target, which is on unpaid care work, there are lots of challenges in regards to unpaid care work, and the women's movement is a strong advocate in order to push for unpaid care work to be recognized. And this is a huge fault line. Efforts to accelerate progress, this must be doubled, because we do see that labor force participation, there is a huge gap. We need to reduce the number of female youth who are not in employment. Although they have education, they are not in employment or in education or in training. And we also need to ensure women's role in decision-making and also tackling violence and harmful practices around women and girls. Now, the other data set that we look at is women and girls spend as much as 11 times more of their day than men and boys on unpaid care work, the reproductive work, the taking care of children, the taking care of elders in the family. And this is work, and this is domestic work, and that is not recognized. Cleaning and collecting fuel. A lot of women and girls, they even drop the actually drop out of school in order to go collect fuel for the families or even collect water. And this continues. We have not yet progressed from here in many of our rural villages. We can go to the next slide. The other target is on ensuring opportunities for leadership and decision making, and taking stock. We see that in terms of access to economic and productive resources, women have less access than men to financial services, productive assets, including land. The land ownership is mostly by men, and it is in most of the cases, women do not have land rights. Rina has also talked about this. And women's representation in decision-making and leadership is also very low in comparison to men. We can go to the next slide. So the last target, and that target is very much focused on universal access to sexual and reproductive health and reproductive rights in alignment with the ICPD Program of Action in Beijing. And ICPD Program of Action in Beijing actually give substantive content in order as to how universal access to sexual and reproductive health and rights can be realized. And we all know that our systems, our health systems are not as good, they are not as functional. And the COVID-19 pandemic has really shown that our health systems are not able to cope with handling any kind of emergencies. And as a result of which, you also see that sexual and reproductive health and rights services are difficult to access for everyone, and especially marginalized, especially young people are at a double disadvantage in terms of access to SRH services. Just taking stock based on, yes, we can go to the next slide, and taking stock on the most recent data, and this is in the context of COVID, maternal mortality. We have made some improvements over a period of time in order to reduce maternal mortality, but as a result of COVID-19, the last 2 years, the maternal mortality ratio, there are estimates show that it can increase in 14 Asia-Pacific countries that are already having a huge burden of maternal deaths. And the numbers are very bad. I mean, in worst case scenario, they can be as much as 263 per 100,000 live births. And in the best case scenario, it can be as much as 214, which is the maternal mortality ratio. This is the projection. And why so? Because the priority is going to managing COVID, which should be also the case. But then sexual and reproductive health services are being deprioritized. And when it comes to unsafe abortions, our region, it has half of all the estimated unsafe abortions globally. And this is, again, a big fault line. The pandemic actually has, we have said that, you know, there is a reversal of many of the indicators. And when it comes to harmful practices, the pandemic, the estimate is that the pandemic can potentially result in 13 million additional child marriages taking place globally. And then we know patriarchy, we know son preference is very much prevalent, and it exists in our region. Next slide. Further touching upon, one of the drivers of high rates of teenage pregnancies in South Asia is also because of early marriage. And early marriage is also an indication that happens in our countries, especially Bangladesh has the highest rates of child marriages. And as a result of child marriage, what happens is you have unintended pregnancies, there is high rates of adolescent fertility, and it is a vicious cycle which puts girl children into the cycle of vulnerability, the cycle of vulnerability to violence, gender-based violence, and all other aspects. And then we have all seen that there has been a huge gap in access to education. And as of April 2021, at least 850 million students have lost their academic year. And since we are talking about sexual and reproductive health and rights, access to comprehensive sexuality education, despite the work that is going on, is still abysmal. There is a lot of progress that needs to be done. Young key population, we are talking about marginalization here. And just one data I want you to look at, and that is 27% of new HIV infections in Asia and the Pacific are among young people. And when we say young people, it's not a homogeneous group. Young gay men and other men who have sex with men, they have accounted for 52% of all new HIV infections. And around 99% of new HIV infections among young people are among young key population. And here, this is the reason why we need to not look at, look at progress in a very siloed way, and not look at progress from a very, data way. We have to look at progress from a very intersectional and, Reena has also talked about, from a very structural and systemic barriers aspect. We can go to the next slide. And then there is no data or very little data is available when you talk about beyond the binary. And this, looking at gender equality, we cannot look at just the binary of men and women. And we need to look at gender in its fullest spectrum and collect data around the fullest spectrum and work towards or have policies, implement policies and plans towards the fullest spectrum, which is again a huge gap. So, this is briefly talking about the COVID-19. As a result of COVID-19, there has been, I've just said this, there's a reversal of progress. Many of the indicators where there was some progress that has been made, now we have just stepped back and a lot more work needs to be done, especially when it comes to gender-based violence, sexual and gender-based violence, maternal mortality, and also in regards to climate action. So a major gap is again lack of disaggregated data, and when we want to make progress around gender equality, women, men, non-binary persons, we are not homogeneous groups. Our backgrounds are different. We experience oppression or opportunities in different ways. And data disaggregation is something that will actually point out to these differentials and help us make better plans around policies, but also implement better plans that will leave no one behind. But again, the data when it comes to gender equality and sexual and reproductive health and rights is very limited. So at the end of the day, I would like to reiterate what the previous speakers have said, and taking stock, we can go to the next slide, and taking stock, the picture doesn't look so good. And although we have international commitments pertaining to gender equality and sexual and reproductive health and rights, what we need to do now is to implement the agreed commitments on gender equality and SRHR, because it's high time we keep implementing the actions in a very coordinated and an integrated manner, taking the structural and systemic barriers into account. These are some of Arrow's publications that can be available for you. Arrow does, one of Arrow's key strategy is monitoring international commitments pertaining to women's health. And we monitor the SDGs. Here we have monitored the goal 5 on gender equality. And we have also looked at sexual and reproductive health and rights. We can go to the next slide. And that's the close. And
thank you, Sai. Thank you very much for showing the darkness around us, because only that will make us strive to lead towards light. And there are a few comments, although we have overshot the time, but I would like to read a few comments which we have and a few questions. There's a comment on Facebook that very good comprehensive presentation by Sai. Is there a global monitoring to ensure domestic laws and policies are in line with global commitments like CEDAW, ICPD, Beijing declaration as well?
Yes, when I think there was a presentation this morning that was made on CEDAW, and CEDAW is a mechanism which also, when the CEDAW committee gives recommendations to the countries, it is a legally binding document which helps, which our governments have to put in place and domesticate these laws and policies. So definitely with regards to CEDAW implementation, we can see, we can have hope to bring it forward. Even the UPR, when the recommendations come, they can actually be implemented on the ground. And that's the reason why it is very important for us to stay connected at the national, regional, and at the global level. So we bring the global commitments back to the country and start domesticating and implementing. The CEDAW is a great instrument, and it's a legally binding instrument, and monitoring CEDAW will be a great way forward.
Okay. There is another comment which says that even before COVID-19, the SDG targets were not on track, in the Asia-Pacific region. And and the comment says that COVID-19 has given the governments a good excuse for poor progress.
Totally agree with you. And I would not comment on that, because I totally agree that there was much less progress. We were never meeting the gender equality goal at any point in time.
Right. And one comment says that emotional violence, which is experienced by so many women and really devastates their lives, is rarely recognized or recorded.
Yes, so physical violence, psychosocial violence, and these are, you know, the categories of violence. Of late, First of all, we do not even have data on the current frameworks of violence, but definitely it is recognized in theory. But I have to say that in terms of collecting data, I am not sure if that progress has been made.
Yes. And a lot many questions on marital rape. Dr. Shamima from Pathfinder International says in Bangladesh, marital rape and intimate partner violence is not considered as violence. And then we have Mency Denimi from PNG asking, is marital rape considered violence in the Pacific nations like PNG or Fiji?
For PNG and Fiji, I will have to check. But as far as I know, around 36 countries, although there is some progress that is being made, but around 36 countries in this region do not recognize marital rape.
Yes. And Nahid Khalid from Pakistan has a question on that, that how did countries where marital rape is a crime make that progress? Any lessons or learnings from them?
At this, in terms of marital rape, there has been progress in some of the countries. In the last 5 years, I think, I can't say which country it is, but there has been a country where marital rape has been recognized as criminal action as well. But I will come back to you on that. I do not have the name of the country at this point.
Okay, and then there is a question a comment from Maisun Rashri. Bangladesh has faced a drastic fall in decreasing child marriages due to the pandemic. I personally have lost friends as they had to drop out from colleges. Their parents thought waiting for the world to get normal is a waste of time, and as the whole education system was off, it was better to get their daughters married.
Yeah.
And to them, marriage is the best solution to enhance their daughter's future.
Yes, and there is evidence that actually shows that there has been a spike in child marriages in Bangladesh, and especially also in humanitarian crisis. This is something like a trend that has been seen, but definitely there is evidence that shows that there is a spike in child marriages in Bangladesh.
Okay, there is a comment, maybe here some significant steps undertaken to advance gender mainstreaming, particularly with SDGs and Objective 5.1 at the ASEAN, given that the issue of gender is taken up by various ASEAN committees and pillars. What could be learned from these steps for organizations who may want to replicate these steps? Along
right.
Which is in the chat box.
Right. Thank you. Thanks for that question. And when we are talking about addressing discriminatory laws around gender, there are different frameworks. We do see that ASEAN has a human rights framework again, and gender equality is also one of the areas of work which ASEAN looks at. And UN Women has a database of all the different gender equality acts or all the different laws and policies that are currently in place. It also goes into what are the different programs and what is the implementation status also. So we can look at those kind of frameworks. But definitely what we see is in terms of laws and policies, some of the countries in the region have made that progress. Even in Malaysia, there is some talk around having a gender equality act in place. We do make, sometimes what happens is we do make progress and get these laws passed in our parliaments, in our countries. But what, when it comes to its implementation, I think the gap is around the implementation mostly. So so that is what we will have to see. Here I also want to give an example about very recently, I think in 2013, many of our colleagues from Bangladesh would know that there was this Child Marriage Restraint Act that was passed. And in the law, it was this, when this law was passed, and many groups have applauded because of course there is a law that is being passed, but then it comes with a clause, and the clause is under special circumstances. So, and these are those loopholes and these gaps, which then makes no meaning for having any progressive laws and policies, because at the end of the day, within these specific clause, we still can make provisions in order to get away from being progressive.
You are very right. Very right, Sai. And thank you very much for the inputs you have given. We have overshot the time by more than half an hour, but that shows how intensely the issues were spoken about and how intensely they were discussed. So thank you very much. And with this, we come to the end of the first day of the Asia Pacific Regional Training Program on Gender Equality and Human Rights. I'm sure our eminent speakers have given us enough food for thought to reflect upon as to where we stand today in terms of gender justice to achieve our goal of a just social order. My sincere thanks to each one of you for being with us here today and making it such a lively session. We meet again tomorrow for two separate sessions, one for gender justice advocates that will begin at the same time as today, that is 11 a.m. Bangkok time, and end at 1:30 p.m. Bangkok time. The second session for media will be held from 3 p.m. Bangkok time to 4:30 p.m. Bangkok time tomorrow. The Zoom link to join tomorrow's sessions will remain the same as that for today. Goodbye till then. Stay safe. Namaste.